Welcome to worship with the First Presbyterian Church of Dallas on this second Sunday of Easter. I'm Amos DeSasa, and today I'm leading worship with Tracy DePew, Rebecca Chancellor Six, and Cheryl Lemons. Wherever you may be, if you're at the breakfast table, in a car, sitting at your desk, or still in your pajamas watching from your couch, be encouraged by the words of the prophet and the poet in Psalm 145, who says, "The Lord is present for all those that ask for help." To all that approach God in truth, God will fulfill the desires of those that fear him. God will hear their cry and will save them. Let us go now into the house of the Lord to worship God.
Let us pray. Creator of the universe, you made the world in beauty and restore all things in glory through the victory of Jesus Christ. We call on you to save us. We come into your presence this day with our love, thanksgiving, and praise. We are your people, your servants. Come, Lord Jesus, and reveal yourself to us this day. Guide us as we seek to bring glory and honor to you. Amen. grace of God overflows for us through Christ Jesus, who came into the world to save sinners. So trusting in God's grace, let us confess our sin. Merciful God, you are our companion on the way, and we yearn for your love and grace, your wisdom and guidance. But sometimes we remain stuck in our fear, our confusion, our despair. We cling to what we have known instead of clinging to you and your promises. And sometimes when we do cling to you, we hoard the blessings of our relationship with you instead of sharing your love with others. Forgive us, Holy One. Remind us that even in these days, your love is to be carried throughout the world. Press us to share the hope and joy of your love so that someone who hungers for spiritual food may be filled by our witness to your grace. Shine the light of your Spirit through us so that we may show your way to those who long for peace. Amen. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone, a new life has begun. Beloved people of God, believe the good news. Through the grace of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. Has forgiven us and extends peace to us. The peace of Christ be with you all. In this moment, I invite you to share signs of Christ's peace and reconciling love with others. You may do this by text, phone, or social media, or if there are other people in your worshiping space, pass the peace with them.
May the peace of Christ be with you.
Peace of Christ be with you.
Peace of Christ to you.
The peace of Christ be with you.
May the peace of Christ be with you, now and forever.
May the peace of Christ be with you.
We are also reminded that the psalmist called on God and asked, "What shall I return to the Lord for all his bounty to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people." We remember that all parts of creation, including us and all that we have, belong to God. And so let us return to God the gifts of our lives and labors. If you would like to make an offering to the church to support our mission and ministry, you may do so by texting FPC Dallas to 77977. You will receive a link on your phone that will direct you to a secure giving page where you can either make a one-time gift or you can set up a recurring gift that will take place on a regular basis as you've set it up. Again, you may text the letters FPC Dallas to 77977.
Scripture reading this morning is from the 24th chapter of Luke, verses 13 through 35. Listen now for God's word as it comes to you and for you. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they were talking with each other about all these things that had happened. And while they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and he went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" And they stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" And he asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and they told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are. And how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah would suffer these things and then enter into glory?' And then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, Jesus walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over.' And so he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And then he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?' That same hour, they got up and they returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, 'The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon.' Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." The title of this sermon is "There Will Be Light." 7 miles outside of Jerusalem, it was getting dark. According to the gospel writer of Luke, Emmaus is about that far away from the city where Jesus was crucified and where he died and where he was buried. But in truth, it's more likely that Emmaus was the gospel writer of Luke's version of Dallas, or Irving, or Waxahachie, or Lagos, Nigeria, or Berlin, Germany, or wherever it is that you presently reside. And Emmaus is the biblical equivalent of Lake Wobegon, that fictional town in Minnesota that was the subject of fictional news reports on the radio show Prairie Home Companion. Emmaus manages to be anywhere and everywhere and nowhere at the same time. The only mention of Emmaus in any historical record is in the passage that we just read from the Gospel of Luke. This leaves us with two choices about how we should proceed. The first option is to, you know, dismiss this post-resurrection account as a figment of this gospel writer's imagination. The story's a good one.
Yeah.
Like the ones in the fictional city of Gotham where Batman lived. But just because I like to watch Batman doesn't mean that I want to be like Batman. Option two. The second option is to not worry about where Emmaus is or whether or not it ever existed. And then when we're unburdened by the complications of moderating the historical accuracy of this mystical and dreamy and dramatic appearance of Jesus, we can receive it for what it was, a true story. A true story, not because it's verified by archaeologists or historians, but because the story has the potential to do something to us when we step inside of it. The first option is going to make for a much shorter sermon. Actually, you know, I could just stop right here and encourage you to read Luke 24, 13 through 35 a couple more times to yourself. Say a prayer. In the name of God, the Creator, Son, and Holy Spirit, worship is over. Return to whatever it was you were doing before you found us online. But I don't want to do that. The second option, it will require us to listen for what is not explicit, yet to dig down below the surface of the facts about who and when and how. The second option will lead us away from the bright light beaming from the transparent facts toward the dark stillness of God's mercy. If you are willing to go there, to the dark, it's possible that we may discover a light that is more luminescent than any we have ever seen. This light does not only shine on us, but it shines from within us. Or as Cleopas and the disciple without a name put it, this light makes our heart burn within us. Yeah, who else was on that road? I know somebody, you know her by name. She's on her way to Emmaus, just like Cleopas and the disciple without a name. She's working longer hours, getting paid the same. Barely has time for her family, much less for herself. The demands of daily life, making all of the ends meet, and keeping companions for the journey that she can trust, and pushing off the load of a nagging sense of loneliness, modeling a whole life that her kids and her parents, maybe even her spouse, finds worthy of admiration, being there for others when all she wants to do is just sleep. The days are either too long or not long enough. But at night, in the dark, it doesn't matter because she's still awake, wondering how and when it's all gonna get better. It's dark in there. She can't see. will there be a light? Well, you know her, and you know about him also. You know him? He can't get right, or at least that's what he tells himself, his autobiography, the narrative that plays on a loop in the background while he walks the streets to Emmaus on his way to work, or while he's watching his son at, you know, soccer practice or football practice, even when he's in the middle of telling someone else that life is good, has never been better. His autobiography, the story he tells himself, is that he is a disappointment. That he could have done better, that he should be doing better, that he should be further along the path towards happiness by now, that he's not good enough. An imposter of the highest order, that fears his impervious cloak of humor and his wit and his indifference will one day be pulled back to reveal the sadness that is common to those of us that don't know how to respond when someone says, "I love you." It's dark in there, and he cannot see. Will there be a light? You know her by name, you know him by name, and you know them by name. They are a family that shares, they share a last name, they share a home, and they file their taxes jointly. But despite the outward appearance of harmony, their put togetherness is a front. They love each other because they're afraid of what might happen if they stop. They love each other out of duty. They do it for right now. Duty and obligation to an ideal that they once imagined was their birthright. That is what is holding it together. There's more than enough money to keep the lights on, but deep down in the darkness that can't be hidden when they are physically separate, but emotionally distant. The light there is not shining. It's dark in there. And they want to know, will there be a light? This sermon is not for those of you that are well. I'm glad you're here. You are welcome to stay. And if you can, take what you can remember from the conversation that we share today and take it to someone that you know that looks like they're stumbling in the dark through the streets of Emmaus. Tell them that they're about to see the light, that there will be a light. Tell them that the light is coming, not from without, but from within, and tell them that the light is enough to save them, to burn them up from the inside. If you gave up your life to follow somebody for 3 years, but now they're dead, I would look for you on the road to Emmaus. If you believe this person, when they said they would save you from suffering, but then you watched him suffer without saving himself, I would look for you on the road to Emmaus. If you witness large crowds gather around him, full of people holding the same expectation that he was the long-awaited savior of your nation, the one to liberate you from captivity and Roman occupation, but then he died, I'd look for you on the road to Emmaus. If you're fearful that your friendship with this enemy of the state and this threat to the ruling religious class might also mean trouble for you, then I would look for you on the road to Emmaus. If you just heard that the tomb in which he was buried is now empty, except for two angels claiming that he isn't dead anymore, and now you're confused, you're startled, you even dubious about this turn of events, I would look for you on the road to Emmaus. When you lose something you thought would be around forever, you will walk on the road to Emmaus. When you are let down by someone who you believed in, you will walk on the road to Emmaus. When life makes an unexpected turn and you aren't sure what comes next, you will walk on the road to Emmaus. And it's there. It's there on the road to Emmaus that Jesus runs into two of his disciples. One of them is called Cleopas, but it's the only mention of him in the Bible. The other disciple doesn't have a name, which is convenient for you and for me, because right there is a blank line for us to insert our name. Jesus recognizes. He recognizes them, but they don't have a clue who he is. There is something about his physical appearance, how he dresses and looks, that there's something about all this that has changed enough to confuse them. The post-resurrection Jesus is consistently portrayed in this way in Luke and in all of the other gospels. He's got hands and feet that bear the scars of an execution by the state, but he also walks straight through closed doors like he's a ghost. He eats and he drinks like an ordinary human, but he's also got extraordinary power to mysteriously appear out of nowhere right beside the people. And while it's easy for us to get caught up in what he looked like and wonder if the same reality of new bodies post-resurrection, wouldn't that be nice for us? Luke doesn't really care and doesn't emphasize Jesus' new body. For Luke, it's the inability of the disciples to recognize him that is most important. If they knew what they were looking for, they'd be hugging him and high-fiving at first glance because Jesus was alive, just like the women said. But even after he interprets the history of Israel through the scriptures, all the way back to Moses and the prophets, revealing how that history was fulfilled through the suffering of the Messiah, whose death they are now mourning, they still don't get it. They don't know who he is. And what makes this encounter on the road to Emmaus between Jesus and two disciples even more intriguing is that their failure to recognize him in that moment is a central theme of Luke's gospel. They are not the first. They're not the first to mistake him as another wise sage or a magician or just an experienced teacher. They're the last of a long line of characters in Luke's gospel that miss Jesus because it's too dark in their life right now. It's too dark for them to notice. Even after he takes them to school for their own private Bible lesson, they still don't get it. It's dark in here. Will there be a light? Well, they remain in the dark. Their darkness is punctuated by a particular flavor of hopelessness. It's the hopelessness that is specific to concluding that you are alone, alive, but apparently transparent to everyone else. Your grief upon the death of unmet expectations, so pervasive that you feel empty, hollow, invisible, Because you believe no one can see you, you have also lost the ability to see others. It's dark in there. Will there be a light? And what happens next was worth waiting 20 verses for. As it's getting dark, Cleopas and the disciple that didn't have a name, they arrive at home in Emmaus, still unaware that their unexpected travel companion is Jesus. We're all going to walk the road to Emmaus, but before you go, I need to give you two travel tips. I got the first travel tip from my father. He has friends all over the place. He picks them up when he's out and about. He'll go to the grocery store and come back with groceries and a friend. He just now ditched his beloved flip phone for a smartphone with a full-size screen just a few months ago. So don't try making friends with him online. He still prints pictures at the drugstore and buys disposable cameras. I have never once received an email from him that contains an attachment. The man does all of his relationshipping in real life, and many of his friendships commenced on the road, away from home. If you're on the road to Emmaus, you should know that you're likely to run into a whole bunch of strangers. Some of the strangers are just like you. They need to escape from this world and experience life in some other, more satisfying form. But there is one stranger, that will find you. It's hard to pick him out among the crowd of strangers, especially if you don't know what you're looking for. But if you pay close enough attention, one of those strangers will be Jesus. That's the first travel tip. If you don't meet a stranger, then you're not on the right road. I got the second travel tip for your journey and down the road to Emmaus from the gospel writer of Luke. As Luke tells it, the journey must end at some point because we cannot stay on the road to Emmaus. Can't do this forever. This journey has a destination. The road to Emmaus will actually take you to Emmaus. And when you arrive, you will need to determine whether or not you're going to invite a stranger that you picked up along the way to stay with you and share a meal. That's the second tip. There will be a light. There will be a light, but you cannot find it by yourself. We will all walk on the road to Emmaus. We'll walk away from what we believed was permanent, and we'll be unsure of what comes next. We'll be disappointed in the life that's been dealt to us. On that dark road to nowhere, you will need to squint to see the light. But it will be there. You'll be distracted by your anger that is directed at Jerusalem, where the darkness of Jesus' tomb is just as thick and disorienting as it was 7 miles back. The darkness will feel claustrophobic, as if you're being trapped. But do not stop walking. The light will be there. The gospel of Jesus Christ says that the light will find us when we find ourselves breaking bread with a stranger. We don't sign contracts to receive access to the light. We don't exchange goods to get access to the light. We don't ask for someone to put in a good word to get access to the light. And access to the light can't be included in our estate planning for our kids to one day enjoy. The light that makes our hearts burn within us is found when we are generous with our hospitality to strangers. We will all walk on the road to Emmaus. What we do with the strangers that we meet is the only question that remains. This past week, the count of Americans that died in this pandemic surpassed 50,000. Soon, we will surpass the total number of Americans that died in Vietnam. The U.S. was in Vietnam for 19 years. The first known death from COVID-19 was 2.5 months ago. We are on the road to Emmaus. The past doesn't seem like it has anything to do with our present. We are on the road to Emmaus. People are dying all the time. Job losses are mounting. Businesses are closing. Lives and livelihoods are disappearing into what looks like a darkness that is spreading. And I pray that we will not stop walking with our heads held up so we can see the Jesus that has always been beside us, but we refuse to invite to dinner. We are on the road to Emmaus. Jesus was, and Jesus is, the stranger doing double shifts at a warehouse so we can enjoy the convenience of same-day delivery. Jesus was, and Jesus is, the stranger that cleans hospital rooms and takes care of our aging parents when we can't be there. Jesus was and is the convenience store clerk that stays smiling when we demand that the pump outside do a better job reading our credit card. Jesus was and Jesus is. The migrant that we now see was always doing our farming. And the immigrant that we now see was always doing our cleaning. We are on the road to Emmaus. And now all the strangers that we barely saw, didn't compensate fairly, made credit impossible to access because their skin was not the right color, and refused to offer health insurance or paid time off. All the strangers, they're disproportionately dying in this pandemic, and they are essentially working so we have bread to break at home. The strangers are doing the dying, and they're doing the working right now. We are all on the road to Emmaus. The light will come. The light will come when we stop confusing the buying of bread from strangers for the breaking of bread with strangers. We are all on the road to Emmaus. And now, even today, even right after this worship service is done, and now we must commit to arriving at home together by finding the courage and the grace to invite the stranger to come on the road with us and to eat from the same loaf that we do. the light that dispels all darkness, came into this world and has never left. And the darkness will never overcome it. And we need the light to see who's always been walking with us. This is my prayer. In the name of God, the Creator, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let us now turn to God in prayers for all people. Let us pray. O God, your Son remained with his disciples after his resurrection, teaching them to love all people as neighbors. As his disciples in this age, we offer our prayers on behalf of the universe in which we are privileged to live and our neighbors with whom we share it. We pray for those who live in poverty, for those who wait for you to be revealed, those in need of clean water, something to eat, a place to sleep, and shelter from the sun. We pray for those who are sick in body, mind, or soul, for those who wait for you to be revealed, those in the hospital or waiting in their own beds, those who are unable to see a doctor, those whose life on this earth is coming to an end. We pray for all the caregivers who serve, for those who wait for you to be revealed, for those in need of peace, rest, and assurance, for those who daily put their own lives at risk in order to offer your love and light. We pray for all who are victims of war, violence, and disaster, for those who wait for you to be revealed, for those who know the realities of daily struggle, for those who have not known peace in a long time, for those who need to see your light shining in the darkness. We pray for your church in every place, for your disciples who wait for you to be revealed, for those who worship you and serve you faithfully, for those who have lots of questions, for those who seek answers, for those who are in awe of your works, and for those who desire to know you more. We pray for leaders and people in every land, for those who wait for you to be revealed, that they may know your way and do your will. We pray for those who are researching, studying, and making critical decisions that affect people all over this earth. We pray for your guidance, wisdom, and urgency. We pray, O God, for the earth you have made, for all of creation, and the ways it waits for you to be revealed, for the beauty that flourishes, for the air, land, and water, for all living things that show your glory and help us to know more of you, our Maker. Holy God, we lift these prayers to you this day as we pray for all of your people, those we know and love, those we have only seen as strangers, and those we have never met, as we all wait for you to be more fully revealed. Open our hearts to your power moving around us and between us and within us until your glory is revealed in our love of both friend and enemy, in communities transformed by justice and compassion, and in the healing of all that is broken. And we pray that wherever your image is still disfigured by poverty, sickness, selfishness, war, and greed, the new creation in Jesus Christ may appear in justice, love, and peace to the glory of your name. Across the distance, O God, gather us up into your one body, as disciples of Christ who pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. People of God, now we have an opportunity to affirm our faith and state what we believe together, using the words of the Apostles' Creed. You are invited to join me. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Now, friends, go in peace. You have been set free to love God with all of your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. And as you go, may the road rise to meet you. and the wind be always at your back, the sun shine warm upon your face, and the rains fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hands. Amen and amen.